I will touch on four topics. First of all, I will give you the overview, give you general pictures about how financial system works in China. Then I will talk about the banking sector, okay, followed by equity market or security market. Finally, I will share with you about my understanding about the new challenges in the near term. This is the financial architecture in China. Once you understand these pictures, you pretty much understand 80% of the financial system in China. So from these diagrams, there are four layers. Okay. At the top it is the National People's Congress. Okay. So as everyone knows here, it is a highest power agent in China, in theory. Okay. It promulgates all financial sector laws, for example, bankruptcy laws, company laws, security laws, and insurance laws, and banking laws, so on. Okay? So this is the top layer, the National People's Congress. The second layer is State Council. The job of State Council is to execute financial regulations and issue some mandatory policies. Okay? So this is the second layer. And the third layer, okay, is related to the functional monetary agencies. Okay, so I use four colors, okay, to classify four major areas in the financial systems. The yellow one represents anything related to the pensions, okay, or the social securities. It is managed by the Minister of the Human Resources and Social Securities. The second sector is related to insurance. Okay? It is administered by the China Insurance Regulatory Commissions. Okay? And the next one is related to security industry. It's regulated by the CSRC, the China Security Regulatory Commission. The largest part is related to the banking sectors. Okay? There are different kind of regulatory agencies. So due to the time constraint, today I'm only going to share with you about the first two. Okay? The banking sectors and the security industries. So this diagram shows the source of external financings. Okay? The majority of them are from the indirect approach, okay? Through the either RMB bank loans, foreign currency bank loans, trust loans, and so on. Okay? The only 15%, okay, of the new capital is raised from the direct market, okay, through the direct approach. Okay, so we're either the equity market or the bond market. So now let's look at the other countries. Okay, let's use the U.S. as examples. Okay, for the U.S. here, we have three sources of financings. Okay, one is the gray bars represent the private sector credit. That means the capital raising from the bank. And the blue ones, okay, is represented the debt security outstandings. The dark blue represent the stock market capitalizations. Okay? So in the United States, the most of capital is raised through corporate bond market. So compared with the US, okay, a developed market, the China as an emerging market, more rely on the indirect financing instead of direct financings. So if you ask me use one sentence to describe the financial system in China, the one sentence will be the China financial system is dominated by the bank. Okay? It's dominated by the state-owned commercial banks. So this is the number, this is the profit, okay? The net profit from the first to third quarters of last year's. Okay? So ICBC, CCB, ABC, and BOC are the top four, okay, bank in terms of profitabilities. At the top, okay, tier is the state-owned banks, okay, namely ICBC, CCB, BOC, and ABCs. A second layer or second tier is these joint stock banks. Okay? For example, the Bank of Communication, CITIC's banks, China Everbright Bank, China Merchant Banks, Guangdong Development Bank, so on. Okay? And the one of them, the Bank of Communication, because its size is much larger than the rest of the joint stock banks. So usually, the Bank of Communication is classified as one of the top five. Okay, so the Bank of Communication is the same group, belongs to the same group as the big four commercial banks. The next layer is the city commercial banks and the rural commercial banks. Okay, for example, Bank of Shanghai, Bank of Beijing, and so on. Okay? And also, there's a bank, foreign banks. Okay, for example, HSBC, Standard Chartered, and Citibanks. By the end of 2011, there were 3,800 financial institutions. Okay, and they employed more than 3 million okay, staffs. Okay, so if you look at the proportions, the largest commercial banks, okay, employ more than half of the staffs. Okay, so the largest five commercial banks, they employ 1.6 million staffs. Okay, so the financial system is dominated by bank. Banking sector is dominated by state-owned commercial banks. The state-owned commercial bank used to own more than 50% of the total assets. Okay? The percentage gradually declined to 44%. So in the early years, okay, like in the early 80s, more than 95% of assets are under management by these four largest state-owned commercial banks. Okay? But still, they play a dominant role. Okay? Although the market share dropped significantly, but they still play a very, very important role in the banking industries. The banking industry is gradually okay open to the foreign players. Okay, so as the market has opened progressively in the years since China joined entered WTOs in 2003. Okay, so it allowed the foreign banks to cooperate locally and to compete on a more even playing field with the local competitors. So the business opportunity has increased dramatically for the foreign institutions. So the foreign banks with the local office outside China that wish to establish branches must have a total assets of $20 billion and a capital adequacy ratios of 8 or higher. So the bank must also have operate a representative office in China for at least 2 years prior to starting up this branch. Although the number of financial institutions and the amount of assets under management by the foreign institutions increased dramatically in the past 10 years, the percentage okay, of the total banking assets remains at 2%. And this diagram shows us the ownership structures. Okay? So in China, majority the shares of commercial banks are owned by the government. Okay, by the government. Okay, it's different from the other countries. Okay, so the consequence, okay, of the government ownership, okay, or the government control, led to non-performing loans. Okay, so because the commercial bank is not profit oriented, okay, they serve as a second government to help to implement some of the macroeconomic policy okay, initiated by the state councils. What kind of loans can be classified as non-performing loans? Okay? So as long as the borrower cannot pay the interest or the principal in 6 months, it was classified as the non-performing loans. Okay, so for example, if originally on the balance sheet of the bank, this amount of loans worth $100, okay? But since they are classified as non-performing loans, okay, so you have this loan must be sold at a discount. Okay, so usually when they establish this fault, nobody has experience. So what's the percentage of discount? Okay, should be priced this non-performing loans. Usually it's set a very low price, let's say 10%. Okay, so the loans on book worth $100, but it was sold at $10 to this assets management corporations. Later on, some of the loans, okay, So some of the projects become profitable. They can pay, okay, the interest and the principal. Okay, so it's worth more than $10. Okay, so this is what I mean. Turn to a non-performing loan into a profitable projects. So let me summarize the Chinese models, okay, in terms of reformings. The first step is partially privatizing large state-owned commercial institutions and converting them into list companies, okay, with a diverse investment base. Okay, since they are listed in Hong Kong, so anyone who is interested in invest, they can purchase the stocks. Okay, so the government still maintain the majority shareholders. This is the how the banking sector reforms in China. Okay, so first through partial privatizations. Okay, then listed in the Hong Kong Stock Exchange. Now I'm going to talk about the new challenges, okay, faced by the commercial banks. Okay, the first challenge is the accelerated market-oriented development, okay, in the interest rate and exchange rate policies, okay, the assets securitization and the capital market development and so on. So the deposit competition become more fierce, okay, and the pricing power for larger size of the company and the middle and the higher end customer were increased. Okay. As a result, the proportion of the direct financing will increase, and the financial intermediaries, the role played by the financial intermediary declines. We call the financial disintermediations will speed up. Okay, so everyone is aware of the competition from the internet finance. So this is why investor is more willing to participate in this kind of internet finance, is because they pay a market rate. Why those big four cannot pay the market rate? Because the interest rate are regulated. Okay, that is simple. Okay, so this is how the internet finance, they can compete with the traditional financial institutions. Although the traditional financial institutions has the monopolies in terms of the number of physical branches. The second challenge is globalizations. Okay, globalizations. So the Chinese enterprises and the personal customers going abroad, okay, activity speed up, okay, recently, and that the Chinese economy will be involved in a global economy more deeply. Okay, so the banking industry still needed to improve its global customer services, okay, global risk management, and global operation supporting capabilities. For example, the ICBC is running, okay, 388 overseas institutions. Okay, the Bank of China is running more than 600 overseas institutions, and so on. Okay, so this is the second challenges. Okay, although the number of foreign institutions overseas institution increases, but as a percentage of total assets, it still counts very small percentage. For example, the ICBC, the overseas assets only counts 2% of the total assets under management. The last challenge, okay, faced by the traditional financial institutions in China is the advanced in technologies. The rapid development of information technology opens a new age of intellectual and mobile world, which is significantly changing the current business models. Okay? So the bank needed to improve the information technology and development in order to fully meet the customer demands. Okay? So this is what we observed, the mergings, okay, the boomings of internet finance. Okay? So some people claim that the internet finance will replace the traditional financial institutions in the near future. But it will not happen soon, okay, based on what we observed recently. In terms of the regulations, new regulations. Okay, so the government look at the issue from the national security, okay, perspective. Okay, they still prefer the traditional institutions to carry out the major roles in the payment and lending and receiving deposit. unfortunately, due to the ownership or due to regulation, the big four commercial banks, they tend to lend money to the state-owned enterprises. Okay? And we know the profitability of state-owned enterprises is lower than the profitability of private sector enterprises. Okay? So in order to allocate the money efficiently, the bank have to change their business models, okay, in my opinion. So that's why the central government fully realized the challenges, okay, in front of that, in front of them. So the government want to introduce the private banks, okay, so allow to open the banking business to the private enterprises, okay, to the foreigners, and also to allow, to a certain extent, allow the growing of internet financial institutions. Okay, so the reason is to give some competition pressures on the traditional financial commercial banks. Okay, so this is they should do. They change their business models, but unfortunately, because they are huge, okay, they are huge. They have already get used to the old models. Okay, so it's difficult for them to reform. By themselves, they need external shock. Okay? The external shock will come from the various players, okay? The private banks, the bank owned by the private firms, the foreign banks, and the internet financial institutions. So this is about the banking sectors. Okay? Now let's move on to the stock market or the security industries. Okay? So as all of you are aware, that there are two stock market in China. One is in Shenzhen, the other is in Shanghai. Okay, the Shenzhen Stock Exchange was established on December 1st, 1990s. Okay, and the Shanghai Stock Exchange was established in the early 1991s. And this diagram shows us the growth. Of the stock markets over time. Okay? So, for example, in 1992, there were only 53 stocks. Okay? So the number of listed companies increased from 53 to 2,500. Okay? 2,500. And the market capitalization also increased significantly, especially during the bubble period. Okay? In 2007, okay, 2006 and 2007. Okay, and there are more and more companies choose to list it overseas. Okay, so the firm can choose IPO at Asia and also choose in the overseas market. Okay, so these two diagrams show the number of IPOs. Okay, domestic IPOs and overseas IPOs. And this diagram shows the amount of capital raised. Okay, so in certain years, for example. In 2006, the amount of capital raised in the overseas IPO exceed the amount of domestic IPOs. It's mainly due to the ICBCs. Okay? So ICBC was listed in Hong Kong Stock Exchange in 2006. Okay? So ICBCs is so far the largest IPO around the world. Okay? Okay? So the majority of the firm choose listing in Hong Kong. Very few firms choose to list in the other markets, for example, the Frankfurt, NYSE, and NASDAQ. Okay? So this is the overseas listings. In my opinion, there are two key criteria for the firm to select the locations. One is the valuations. Okay? How popular the stock will be, okay, after it got listed. The second one is the regulation environment or legal environment. Suppose you invest $1, okay, by the end of 92, so the $1 increased to $1.50, okay, in China, and the $1 becomes $2.50 in India, and becomes $2 in the SP 500. Okay, so the stock market is poorly performed. Okay, so in other words, the stock market in China. Losing its power in allocating capitals. Okay? There are several factors, okay, on the poor performance. Okay? The first factor is the over-regulations and the limited enforcement. Okay? So the stock market in China is heavily regulated. Start from the IPO, okay, to the dividend policies. Everything is regulated by CSRCs. Okay? What is the IPO price? Okay? How much dividend you should issue? If you want to raise capital again, what is the ROE you have to meet? Okay, so it's a high, it's over regulations, but with limited enforcement. So suppose one company violated some of the rules, okay, they're not enforced, okay, or selected enforced. Okay? The second reason is the opacities of the information environment. Okay, so the there's a huge information asymmetries in this market. Okay? The next one is limited financial markets and products. Okay? It's not completed. Okay? So as I explained before, the margin tradings and short sellings was introduced recently. Okay? So it's not a complete market. The other reason is the frauds, lots of frauds, okay, accounting frauds. And the last reasons, okay, on poor performance is due to a lacking of institutional investors. The first challenge is the slowing down of the overall economic growth. Okay? So if you read the newspaper, you are aware of that. Okay? So this is the GDP. The trends of the GDP growth rate, okay, over time, okay, from double digit, okay, gradually declined to single digit, okay. Now the government tend to stabilize it at 7.5%. Okay, so this is kind of the minimum, okay, target of GDP growth every year. It's about 7.5%. So in the past 30 years, what is the major driving force behind the economic growth in China? Investment or the net export or consumption? Investments. Okay? It is investment-driven economies. So when the return of the investment is slowing down, it will lead to slowing down in the GDP growth rate. Okay? Now let's look at the returns. So this is the returns. This is the returns on the return on investment. So the old days, it's about 18%. Okay. Now the number gradually declined to 12%. Okay. So it's not surprising we observe the decline in the GDP growth rate. Okay. Because the cost increases and due to the overcapacity. The efficiency, okay, level declines. So how to maintain the growth? The only way left is the increase in the land, the borrowings. Okay, so this leads to the second risk, is the recent shock in credit expansions, okay, on the bank's asset qualities. This is the second, the challenges. First one is the slowing down in the economy. Why is the slowing down economy? It's because the cost, okay, went up, and also due to the overcapacity issue, okay, lead to lower asset turnover ratios. So in order to maintain, okay, constant growth rate, okay, in order to maintain a constant growth rate or the profitabilities, you have to leverage up. Okay? So the country have to leverage up, the corporation have to leverage up. Okay? So that's the second challenge. Okay? We are facing today. And people will say, why? Okay? Why? What's the driving force for the higher real estate prices? Okay? First one is the higher income growth. Okay? So in the past 30 years, the average income level, okay, increased significantly. Okay? So here, it's increased. This is the income per capita in the urban. This is the capital income in the rural areas. So increase significantly. Okay? So that's the first reason. Second reason is the low return on the deposit. Okay? So as I explained before, the deposit rate is heavily regulated in China. Okay? So in certain years, the inflation rate is higher than the deposit rate. So the real interest rate is negative. Okay, as a rational investor, you will choose the investment will help you to hedge against inflation risk. Okay? So because the return is negative, you will choose to buy property. So that's the second reason. The third reason is in China, there is a lacking of alternative investment vehicles. Okay? So this is always the common complaint you heard from your parents. I have the money. Where should I put the money? Okay? I cannot put it in the stock market. That's right. I cannot put the money overseas because the government regulations. Okay? So the only alternative investment vehicle available for me is the real estate. Another reason is claimed by most scholars is due to the urbanizations. Okay? And more people migrate from the rural area to the cities. Okay? So this diagram shows the trends in the urbanization in China from 1990 to 2011. Okay? So the urbanization rate passed over 50%, okay, by the end of 11. Okay? So the numbers still keep going up. The next reason is called conspiracy reasons, okay? Because who control the land in China? The government control the land, okay? So government obviously want to sell the land at the higher price, okay? Because the reform in the taxations, okay? So in the old days, some of the taxations are shared by a local government and a central government, okay? So after tax reforms, okay, so the local government has found their own way, okay, to generate revenues, okay? So the only way for them to generate revenue consistently over time is through selling the land, okay? Now, in other words, the local government becomes addicted to the land, okay? So they heavily rely on the land. This is the figures. The blue bar represents the gross income from the land market sellings. And the red bar represents the local market, the budgetary incomes. Okay, so in certain years, the ratio, okay, is close to 70%. In other words, on average, 70% of the budget are from the land sellings. There are other reasons to explain the higher real estate prices. One is due to a lower cost of home ownership. Okay. China is very few countries without the property tax. So that's why when you work around the new neighborhood, okay, newly developed neighborhood, okay, most of the rooms are dark. Okay, it's because they're empty, not occupied. Okay, the apartment are already sold, okay? But nobody occupies it, okay? Nobody utilizes it, okay? So due to the low cost of ownership. The next one is imbalance across regions. We have 31 provinces, okay? So if you look at the richest one is Shanghai. The GDP per capita in Shanghai is equivalent to that in Saudi Arabia, okay? However, in certain regions, for example, Tibet, okay, the average GDP per capita is equivalent to the poorest country in Africa, Congo. Okay, so this is the imbalance across regions. The next challenge we are facing today is the rise of called off balance sheet exposure, okay, which is the shadow banking. Okay. The shadow banking system is the collections of no banking financial intermediaries that provide services similar to the traditional commercial banks. Although they are not a bank, but they provide the bank services. And how serious is, okay, if we just look at the China, okay, as an isolated case, it's very serious, okay, because the shadow banking accounts for the GDP. Okay, as the percent GDP is about close to 21%. Okay, 21%. But if you look at the other countries, for example, Japan, the public debt as the percentage of GDP exceeds 200%. United States exceed 100%. Okay, so although the local government debt is a serious concern here, but it's not out of control. It's still within the management. Okay, so why I say that? Because China has accumulated a huge amount of foreign reserve. Okay. In the past 30 years. Now the foreign reserve more than $3.8 trillion. Okay? So even there's a wave of financial distress, okay? The government still have the capability to handle that.